If you've been online recently or generally have a pop culture pulse, you've probably seen that the Walt Disney Company is having a hard time. Folks on YouTube, Twitter, hell, even the grandmas on Facebook are all hammering just how down bad Mickey's once beloved empire is. The most common critique is that the company, and especially its management, have lost the magic of past eras, with films flopping, park quality diminishing, and stock prices suffering. Things have gotten so bad that there's rumors that Disney, the largest media conglomerate in the world, might be split up or even sold off to someone like Amazon or Apple or even Elon Musk. There's even a push from a group of shareholders trying to launch what could easily be called a revolt against the company's longtime management under the aptly titled Restore the Magic campaign. Times are dark in the House of Mouse, but what if I told you that all of this, from the boardroom squabbles to the rumors of being split apart and bought out, has happened before? For you might not know it now, but just before Disney entered what many call its Renaissance period, financial analysts and corporate leadership were having some of the same problems. Then, what if I told you that a most unlikely hero swooped in to save the day? A relatively quiet family from a little place called Fort Worth, Texas. Well, this is that story. But first, a quick explanation. If you can't tell, I'm a born and raised Fort Worther, and I love my hometown. I also love history, and not just the bland, oversimplified 5 or 6 points typically hammered home on any given topic. I like to learn about the niche things, the things that you, funny enough, have a hard time finding on platforms like YouTube, and you end up having to ask a buddy of yours to fill you in. Well, I want to be that buddy. Especially with the massive influx of folks moving in. Currently, Texas is on track to be the most populated state within the next couple of decades, and the DFW Metroplex is projected to be on par with LA or Chicago in the same time. So I figured I'd try out explaining some of the area's real-life lore. Maybe you're one of those move-ins and you're wanting to learn some about your new home, or maybe you're just such a sports junkie like me that you love learning about the community surrounding some of your favorite teams. Or maybe you just like to listen to a quick history video while you're fixing lunch. Tinny and all, I say welcome. For those of y'all that are here for my sports content, consider this a big fat warning that we're fixing to take a big old detour from my first two videos. But don't turn it off just yet, because I've got a feeling that you're gonna like this one all the same. Speaking of, consider this your extremely subtle reminder to like, comment, and subscribe to the channel, because all hail Hypnotoad. Following Walt Disney's death in 1966, the Disney Company steadily declined. The company, which was once the cutting edge of entertainment and symbolized everything that one would think of when describing Americana, had become stale, seeming to lose touch with their audience. The 70s saw such bangers as The Cat from Outer Space, The Boy Who Talked to Badgers, and who could forget Gus?
Leave me alone!
Akira!
That's not to say everything was terrible, as they still made future classics like Aristocats, Robin Hood, and the GOAT, Herbie. I mean, just look at that adorable little guy, just living in the moment. He's literally me. Just don't ask me what he was doing in the 1940s. And thus, we enter the 80s, a decade of shooting commies, saying no to drugs, and corporate raiders. What's a corporate raider, you ask? Well, the long and short of it is that a corporate raider is someone, or more often a group of people, who see a vulnerable company and think to themselves, you know what, I bet if I got the lads together and we bought up enough shares and we get a controlling interest of the company, we could put ourselves in charge. Then once we're in charge, we could crank up the productivity and squeeze out a whole bunch of profits in the short term, then dump the whole thing before it all goes belly up. It's not a direct comparison, but you could think of it as something similar to flipping houses. You buy the house, gut the inside, slap some quick set and drywall on that bad boy, and sell it for a 30% profit. Does it help the company? In the short term, yeah, it'll drive up the stock price. But in the long term, just like a flipped house, it's a strategy that calls for speed, usually leaving nothing but the bones by the end of it all. And this is what the Disney Company was looking at in the early 80s. Years of duds and poor investments dropped their stock price like an anchor. And this anchor acted like a dinner bell to the hungry sharks circling Mickey and his friends.
Mark, the legendary monster of the depths.
Saul Steinberg.
New York investor Saul Steinberg had already made a name for himself as one of America's most successful corporate raiders. Like a mosquito, Steinberg had a skill for finding vulnerable companies, swooping in to increase their profits, and then throwing them to the wolves as soon as he and his buddies were done. He'd been so successful at this that the mere presence of him buying stock from your company was enough to scare your board into buying his shares back, usually at a massive premium. I can't overemphasize just how impactful this is. This man had made a name for himself like a Wall Street Genghis Khan, where the mere presence of him outside of your city's walls was enough to send nobles scrounging together every piece of gold they could find just for the hope of being spared. Steinberg was the best in the game, and he just set his eyes on his next target. With Disney stock continuing to fall, bouncing between the high 40s and low 50s per share, this signaled that the company was within striking distance. Steinberg started buying, eventually gaining ownership of a staggering 12.1% of all Disney stock. To put that in comparison, the largest owner of Disney stock today is Vanguard, with a little under 8.3% of Disney's total stock. And the current shakeup attempt led by investor Nelson Peltz's Trian Fund Management owns a whopping 1.76%. The board knew that they were in trouble, and it looked like they didn't have any good options. One idea would be purchasing another company, thus diluting the Disney shares as a whole. This would reduce Steinberg's overall percentage, but it would also diminish the value of their current shareholders, solving the Steinberg problem, but creating a separate list of financial issues that they need to solve as well. Another idea would be for the Disney company to split off into multiple smaller corporations, separating the film studio from the parks and so on. Walt's nephew, Roy Disney, couldn't stand the thought of this. Then there was the really costly option, giving in to the threat of Steinberg's attempt to take over and buying back his massive amount of shares at an enormous premium. Of course, this came with its own set of problems, like the possibility that Steinberg wouldn't go away, and the biggest problem, where could they possibly get that amount of money? After all, the reason the company was in this position in the first place was because their pocketbooks were running dry. If Disney was going to survive, they'd need a hero. The story of the Basses has its roots with another famous Fort Worther, Sid Richardson. Yes, Horned Frogs, that's Sid Richardson, and that's Sid Richardson, and that's Sid Richardson. As local legend has it, Sid got a start with 40 bucks he borrowed from his sister. From those humble Texan beginnings, he built his fortune after discovering the Keystone oil field out in Winkler County, west of Midland in Odessa. An old school oil man, Richardson exhibited everything that the country came to admire about Texas's self-made millionaires. Loud and jovial, he didn't flaunt his wealth, didn't cash out and move to LA or New York and live the life of a movie star. He instead focused on building his family's wealth and contributing to the local development of local communities, a trait he'd passed down to his heirs. A woman who knew him described him as, quote, strictly Texas, Texas all the way, and that he'd, quote, give you his last dime if you needed it. At his death in 1959, the bulk of the lifelong bachelor's fortune, some $71 million, was passed down to the Sid Richardson Foundation. Outside this, Sid Richardson left $12.5 million to his nephew, Perry Bass, who he'd always been close to. Perry had already become a successful oil man in his own right, and had married Nancy Lee Muse from another prominent Fort Worth family. Alongside this, Richardson left $2.8 million to each of Perry's four sons, Lee, Robert, Edward, and the eldest, Sid Richardson Bass. Not wanting his young sons to squander their money, Perry placed their four inheritances into a company called Bass Brothers Enterprises, and began training his sons, most notably the then 17-year-old Sid Bass, on how to manage it. As the brothers grew, their father continued to train them and grow the family's holdings. By 1965, just 6 years after his namesake had passed, Sid had graduated Yale and was crossing the country to Stanford's business school, though he briefly considered joining an art school before he decided against it in the understanding of his place in the family business. And in 1969, only 1 year after graduating Stanford, Sid's father, Harry, turned Bass Brothers over to him, telling him, "It's your responsibility now, I'm going sailing." I'm on a boat and it's going fast and I got an article theme, pass me the Afghan. Sid, only 27 at the time, was now at the helm of a $50 million portfolio. For anyone else, this task would be far too daunting, but Sid Bass wasn't just anyone. He had a keen eye for valuing companies on his own, something which was readily apparent from his time in business school. But his real secret weapon was his ability to surround himself with people who knew more than he did. If he made a mistake, he'd own up to it. If someone else knew a better idea, he'd follow it. And that someone just so happened to be another Fort Worther from his days at Stanford, Richard Rainwater. As the story goes, Rainwater and Bass were good friends in school. Sid admired Rainwater's skill for spotting duds and, more importantly, golden eggs in the market. Once their time in school was up, Sid suggested to his friend that he should come back to Fort Worth and manage the Bass family's investments. Seeing the opportunity, Rainwater accepted. Through the 70s, Sid and Richard worked to diversify the family's holdings away from exclusively oil and gas, likely sparked by the Arab oil embargo of 73 and 74. The pair also realized that a diverse group of investments grew much quicker than focusing on a single industry. Specifically, they separated themselves from the growing trend of corporate raiders by buying into companies for the long term, rather than the aggressive flipping of men like Steinberg. When the Basses bought into a company, they'd shake up the old management, usually by suggesting new leadership, then sit back and watch their valuation rise over time, rarely ever feeling the need to take direct leadership. This strategy ballooned their wealth exponentially, and just like the namesake before him, Sid Bass focused on being a booster for his hometown. They almost single-handedly revitalized downtown Fort Worth with numerous projects, the most notable being the construction of two glass towers known as the Fort Worth Twins or simply as the Bass Buildings. This is where they headquartered their organization. organization. In 1981, they invested $165 million into Marathon Oil for a 5.1 stake, just a week away from a hostile takeover battle, making their money back alongside a profit of $160 million. A few years later, they took a 9.9 stake out of Texaco and made a mouthwatering $450 million after the board had to buy them out when they refused to support Texaco's purchase of Getty Oil. With all this cash on hand, they set their eyes on their greatest buy yet, Disney. Disney's situation in 1984 was grim. Facing the end of the line and with Steinberg banging at the gate, it looked like all hope was lost. Roy Disney had even stepped down from the board in a public display of frustration with the current state of the company, hoping to rally enough investors for his own takeover, but nobody would budge. Then, like it is the last act of a Disney classic like Snow White or Sleeping Beauty, in came the Bassetts. Sid and Richard had a creative solution for handling the attempted takeover. Realizing that the company, taking on more debt, would diminish Steinberg's holdings, the Bassetts offered to sell a heavily debt-laden Florida real estate company that they'd purchased the previous year. Most importantly, the payment of the purchase would come in the form of stock, not cash, thus killing two birds with one stone by building the Basses up to rival Steinberg's position, as well as diminishing his value by taking on more debt. Of course, this would mean that the Basses would now be in position to strike if they wanted, but their reputation over the years as long-term investors helped show the beleaguered board that this was an offer of friendship, not a prelude to war. Disney accepted the deal, and overnight, the Bass brothers received a 10%, $200 million stake in the company. Undeterred, Steinberg turned up the heat, attempting to outright buy a controlling interest in the company that summer but being defeated. In the coming months, the Basses poured even more cash into the struggling company, eventually securing 24.9% ownership of all Disney stock, by far making them the largest single owner. Again, when Steinberg set out for his initial hostile takeover, he had 12.1%, and the current power grab by Nelson Peltz is less than 1.8%, so you have to understand two things. First being the absurd amount of power and influence that owning nearly a quarter of a massive corporation gives you. And second, that with their position, the Basses probably could have taken over all of Disney if they wanted. But true to their reputation, Sid Bass and Richard Rainwater weren't raiders. They were in it for the long term. In the coming months, Sid led the restructuring of the Disney business, from everything from their makeup of the board to their new growth strategy. None of the Bass brothers or Rainwater ever took a position on the board outright, though they certainly could have. Instead, they operated from the background, with the same Texan anonymity that Sid Richard had before. By the end of the year, Roy Disney was back on the board. The former CEO, Ron Miller, had been ousted. And most importantly, a new leader was crowned CEO of Disney after being handpicked by Sid Bass, the president of Paramount Pictures, Michael Eisner. Nowadays, Eisner catches a lot of flack for some of his later decisions like Euro Disney.
I give you
Euro Disney.
But we have to remember the state of the company beforehand, where they'd failed to capture the magic of the Golden Age, and they were under constant threat of takeovers or dissolution. In just a few years from his start as CEO in 1984, he'd not only rebuilt the dying Disney, but made it into one of the largest media conglomerates in the world. This new model of telling stunning animated stories as Broadway musicals was exactly what Sid Bass had in mind when picking Eisner for the job, as Eisner's history as show business, both with film and stage productions, was seen as an essential skill of the culture-loving Sid Bass, who might have opted for business school instead of studying art, but he never lost his love for the medium. When questioned on it, many said that Sid and Michael were incredibly close. When another was asked about Sid's official position within the Disney company, the source said that Sid Bass's position was similar to an of counsel, if anything. The investment paid off, and was Rainwater's greatest success to date. After starting with a portfolio just $50 million, the pair had grown the Bass fortune to $4 billion in less than 18 years. Sid loved the company, and would often say, "The Disney stock is going to be in my estate when I die," showing just how much he was in it for long term. So what ended up happening? In the years following Sid Bass's bailout at Disney, the company skyrocketed with growth. Success of movie musicals opened up opportunities to expand. Before he became CEO, there were only four Disney parks, but Eisner saw the value in expanding with the creation of MGM, now Hollywood Studios, Animal Kingdom, Typhoon Lagoon, Blizzard Beach, California Adventure, and Euro Disney, now Disneyland Paris. Likewise, their film studio expanded, partnering with up-and-comer Pixar, who the company would later on acquire outright. If this was one of their movies, it would have seemed like everyone was riding off into the sunset, but it wasn't. Only a few years after successfully revitalizing Disney, Sid Bass's longtime advisor, Richard Rainwater, said he wanted to go out on his own. Sid supported his friend and thanked him for everything he'd done for the family. Rainwater went on to become one of the most successful investors in the country, making a fortune in real estate, oil and gas, and even becoming one of the owners of Tarrant County's own Texas Rangers, World Series champs, by the way. When he died in 2015, he'd amassed an estimated net worth of $3 billion. Michael Eisner carried on as Disney's fearless CEO and seemed to have the Midas touch, turning everything he had into gold. In reality, not everything he did was a hit, but at least he was trying something, as opposed to the former corporate management who had grown too complacent in their ways and not wanting to take any risks. One of the key voices that kept Eisner's ambitious mind at bay was his loyal secondary, Frank Wells. If Eisner was to create a force, then Wells was the logical backbone who knew how to channel that energy or when it was going too far, forming a very similar relationship to the brothers Walt and Roy Disney back in the origins of the company. However, tragedy struck in 1994 when Frank Wells died in a helicopter crash. Without Wells there to rein him in, Eisner let loose. Even worse was the fact that after so many years of success, a cult of personality had formed around Eisner inside of the company, leading to him being surrounded by ambitious yes-men. So, after Wells' death, cracks started to form and the company began to stagnate. At the same time, while the Bass family's holdings were still strong, they were tight on cash. Sid had started borrowing money on margin and putting up their Disney stock as collateral. If this was a New York or West Coast billionaire, this wouldn't seem like that much of a surprise. But Sid Bass? Even with this astonishing fortune, he was never known as greedy. In fact, he was known as quite the contrary, with him using his new Disney wealth to further develop his hometown by building museums, funding the local university TCU, and creating a state-of-the-art performance hall downtown to host the city's opera, ballet, and orchestra, and even hiring the designer of Epcot's Land Pavilion to rebuild downtown Fort Worth's Sundance Square. Even without Rainwater's advice, Sid Bass continued to grow the family's holdings and enjoy his place in the Disney organization, regularly giving Disney stock away for birthday and Christmas presents, along with taking his kids to Disney's private island in the Bahamas. However, as the 90s went on, Sid began to make a few mistakes, mostly getting caught up in speculations around the telecommunications market. Investments like this quickly ate away the family's cash, meaning that they needed to take out loans. The most secured holding they had to put up for collateral? The Disney stock, which continued to climb in value. However, after the telecoms crash of early 2001, Sid Bass's position was becoming more dire. Later that year, Sid Bass called his friend, Michael Eisner, while he was on vacation in Rome. Eisner was shocked to hear about Sid's position and how vulnerable his family's Disney stock was. If the banks called up the Bass's loans, then Sid wouldn't have enough cash to pay them. But at the same time, it was so unlikely that the banks would do that. It would take something to scare them so bad that they'd be forced to call in their loans. Something unheard of. It would take something impossible. Something only a few days away. The terrorist attacks of 2001 shook the world to its core. Of the many industries affected in the aftermath, tourism was hit the hardest. So, just days after the attacks, and as Disney stock continued to fall, the banks called up the Bass's loans, and Sid, stuck in Europe and dictating orders by hotel phone, made the impossible decision to sell his family's Disney stock, dropping down to just 2.9% ownership, which would only become more diluted in the next two decades, with Disney acquiring more and more companies like Marvel, Lucasfilms, and Fox. Without his strongest supporter, Michael Eisner's days as CEO were numbered, and he began to face pushback in 2003, and was eventually replaced by Bob Iger in 2005. A week after the sale of their Disney holdings, Sid and his wife Mercedes hosted a dinner for their friends, including the Eisners, at their New York apartment. Though it was practically a toast to the end of an era, guests recall that Sid handled it well. During the dinner, Eisner toasted the Basses, likely knowing what the loss of his closest confidant would eventually mean for him. Later, Eisner revered Sid by saying, quote, "I've never had anybody who's had a bigger disappointment, who handled it the way that Sid did. Total professional, total gentleman." When I asked him, was it really this person's fault or that person's fault or somebody inside the operation? He said, no. If you have to put the blame anywhere, I'm the one to blame. But what do you think? This is my first time doing a video outside of sports-related content, and it's something that I really, really wanted to talk about. I've grown up in Fort Worth forever, so I've known this story, and I just thought it'd be fun to get it out there, because I don't see many folks talking about it. You know, maybe you guys want to see more content like this, or maybe you want me to strictly stick to sports-related content. Whatever it is, let me know below, and as always, I will catch you on the next one.